Welcome to your new favorite podcast, Coffee Chronicles with the Z, with your girl L Stokes, Megan S, Mimi J, and our special guest, Emmanuel Ward, who is a data architect. So grab your favorite coffee cup with your drink of choice and join us on this conversation journey. So, as mentioned, family, we have a special guest, Emmanuel Ward, who's a data architect, who has taken a strong interest in researching the available data concerning the COVID-19 vaccines. Yes, plural, vaccines, because we're on number three now. So, I will let you tell the Coffee Chronicles family more about yourself, Emmanuel. Go ahead and welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, no, thank you all for having me. As you mentioned, I am a data architect, but I want to make a couple things clear from the outset. Before I present this information, I'm not a medical professional, nor am I a traditional scientist. I am a computer scientist, as mentioned, a data architect, which is a fancy way of saying that I create computer processes that move data from whatever the source is to a platform where people can then analyze that data to make better decisions. As you mentioned, I've taken an interest in vaccines and vaccinations. That's one thing I wanted to clear up from jump. And that is, just because you have a vaccine, just because you have the medicine, if people don't take it, it's not a vaccination until it's in somebody's arm. You know what I'm saying? So if it's not in the system, it doesn't work. But before we get into who's taking them and what's available, let's talk about what they are, right? So I'm not going to go down the whole list, but I'm going to talk about the three that are now available in the U.S., and that's the Pfizer vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, and the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. A couple things about it. Pfizer and Moderna are what's called mRNA vaccines, which are the newer kind. We've never created vaccines in this manner before. And where the Johnson & Johnson is a more traditional style virus that is made with what's called an adenovirus. I'll talk about those in a quick second. mRNA works. It provides the genetic instructions inside of an artificial shell, which, if you've heard about the fact that these vaccines, have to be, refrigerated at really deep, below sub-zero temperatures. The reason why is because there's an artificial container that's made to carry this messenger RNA, another, the genetic instructions that allow your body to generate the proteins that then immunize you from this virus. So that's both Pfizer and Moderna work that way. Johnson & Johnson is more traditional, works with an adenovirus, which is where the genetic material that helps your body identify this coronavirus is actually put inside a harmless virus. Sounds a little crazy. They've been doing that one for years. That, like, a harmless virus will give you might give you some flu symptoms. But the thing is that that container does not require sub-zero refrigeration in order to make sure that it's still viable. So there's some pros and cons about that. But mRNA, again, that's the newer one. The adenovirus, that's the more old school style of creating vaccinations. One thing I want to say about those is, I think it was mentioned Operation Warp Speed was used to create, actually all of these, vaccines, because we were in such, it was such a pan, the pandemic came on us in such a rush that the only response was to break down the standard hurdles and some of the protocols for creating these vaccines and doing it in a much more expeditious manner. Now that sounds a little scary, because just like, you remember that when people talked about, like, 1 hour, you can get your glasses made in 1 hour. People are like, maybe I don't need my glasses made that fast. Maybe I just, I'll wait a day if they work better. Right. And so people can be concerned about the fact that they were made so quickly. I know that's put a lot of fear and apprehension in people. But the good thing to note about that is some of what they did was really, they just stacked trials on top of each other. Trials that they would normally do back to back to back, they just did those trials, simultaneously. So they didn't skip anything. They just did things, simultaneously, which then again, of course, saves that time. So it's, I know, again, the apprehension in people's minds, hopefully that'll put some of that to rest, because the fact of the matter is that all of these vaccines had to pass the same tests that any other vaccine has. They didn't skip the approval process. They just sped up some of the things that traditionally we had designed to take longer. But again, because of the pandemic, we just didn't have that much time. So,
I have a question. I just have a quick question on that. Because they sped up the process, Why don't they normally do that? I don't know if you know the answer to this, but why don't they normally do that anyway? Is it because of money, or what is the holdup for that?
That is a great, great question. And it's interesting. The I think it's kind of like how, you know, how they sometimes say like pressure makes diamonds, right? Where they didn't think that they needed to, like, it was like almost like because the pressure wasn't there to accelerate it. They didn't try. They didn't even explore that opportunity. It's kind of just like, if you think about it, it's like, well, if companies can save this much money with people working at home during a pandemic and not spend money on commercial real estate, why do we have that many people in the office in the first place? It's just because that's how things were done. And people just didn't review and look at it and kind of analyze it in that way to see if that was possible. But as you know, certain companies now, they're definitely going to be looking at, okay, we don't need that many people in the office. We don't need that big of an office. We can save all kinds of money on liability, on the HVAC, the air conditioning, you know, like just there's so much on the parking structure. Like there's so much that people are going to review based on what we were kind of forced into because of the result of this pandemic and how quickly it came upon us.
Right, right. And definitely what you're saying is, I think, is on a lot of people's minds. And I didn't know if Megan, as you wanted to elaborate on anything.
Well, no, I just had a question for Iman, kind of to piggyback off of what Mimi J was saying. Do you think from an economic standpoint that pharmaceutical companies would, it would be advantageous for them to speed that process up every time they're doing research or trying to find a vaccine? Because I think they would make more money based on the research than they do off of the vaccine once it's approved, right?
So if I hear you right, you're asking, might they use some of these more efficient or expedited processes in the future to make vaccines? And would it be worth their while to do that, or to keep the more traditional cadence or timeline as they've done in the past to kind of keep doing the research and make money that way? Right. Is that right?
Right. That, yes.
Yeah. So I believe that they, from what I've seen, I think a lot of these companies are going to use what they've learned from this particular set of circumstances and definitely get them out to market faster. Because one of the things, I mean, it's true that certain types of research can generate money, but there's nothing like the actual medicine. Now, mind you, they may try to, as the medical profession does, they might try to give us treatment instead of a cure.
Because ain't no money in the cure. The money's in the medicine. That's how you get paid on the comeback.
That's the way they make, that's that annuity, you know, like they make the money every year. But it looks like that's going to happen anyway. Kind of like, I think what's been talked about is this is going to evolve into some sort of annual vaccine, just like the flu vaccine. Maybe one of these companies will come up with like one that it's a twofer, where it handles both the flu and this particular style of, or this particular version of the coronavirus, COVID-19 as well, like wrapped up into one. And so it'll be interesting to see what these businesses choose to do, but there's no question that this has been a game changer, and that they're definitely going to be making things differently going forward.
Yeah, I think Operation Warp Speed has showed success in so many ways, but of course we're still within such a trial and error basis because so many people are still getting it with the body, you know, differences. Like myself personally, I never had the flu shot, but I do know I have a family member that's allergic to the flu shot. And then I have to wear my kids actually get it because they had it. So, you know, just with, like you said, personal reasons, previous health experiences, that's how it is. So one thing I know with you, in your profession, you know, you read miles and miles of data. Mm-hmm. And of course, within this world, we are made up of different races, of course. Mm-hmm. So one thing I want to address, of course, is the African-American community. Do you feel, or why do you feel African-Americans are skeptical about taking this vaccine? Of course, I don't know, within your personal research, have you looked at, you know, different races, from Hispanic to African-Americans, Caucasians, or can you just elaborate on that?
Sure. And yes, it is unfortunate, the African American experience and the U.S. Or American medical history, you know, the history in this country, initially, enslaved Africans were, they were experimented on in so many different and horrific ways. And that is something that most of us know from, either family anecdotes or from some of the history that has become a lot more apparent these days. I certainly didn't grow up, you know, in school hearing a lot about that. It was, you know, more when I got to like the later years of high school and college, where I heard about some of these awful things that it was really kind of hard for me to believe that they were doing that. you know, of course, then when you step back and you realize the whole, you know, the whole institution of slavery, and you're like, well, they were doing everything and everything, and, you know, just all kinds of evil that we can't even speak about. But so we shouldn't be surprised that part of that medical people are like, oh, well, you know, let me get a couple of them and see what happens. You know, so we African Americans have reason, you know, have history and solid long standing reasons to be skeptical and even fearful of some of this. The Tuskegee experiments where they told these men to come in for treatment for syphilis, but they didn't actually treat them for syphilis. They gave them placebos or other things that just didn't, so that they could, but the real harm in that was, they extended it. They did it for years, for like years, so they could see what does syphilis look like long-term if it goes untreated. You know, even during Jim Crow days, they were treating, you know, African-American patients had a hard time finding, doctors that they could even trust, to do just basic healthcare. So, let me stop on that point. But the reason why I have more confidence in what's happening right now than some of that history is because they actually did use some Black and Brown people in trials. And the fact that in this case, we're kind of all in this together, in the sense that, there's no real benefit to mistreating, you know, Black and Brown people for those that don't care about Black and Brown people. The benefit is getting rid of it entirely. If there's any group of people that still has it, even like if they decided to do that, to kind of ostracize or not treat people properly, it would end up coming bite. It would bite them. It would bite them in the butt later on because it's the coronavirus. It's too infectious. And so, it's kind of like because of the situation, I'm not trusting them because all of a sudden I'm like, oh, people turn, you know, like people change their minds or they suddenly become saintly. That's not why. It's because it's that serious and they have it. It has to be dealt with on the whole. So I don't think that they can't risk.
Right.
Mistreating us in this instance. So.
And you're right about that because with, I can't remember her name. If one of you guys want to refresh my memory, the female doctor who is African-American was on the front line. Mm-hmm. And I think also they did that maybe because of a part of history mm-hmm. that we cannot deny in mm-hmm. order just to say, well, hey, you know, this is not what it is, but you know, that fear will always be there. And one thing just to rewind and just to kind of touch on this with your own personal research, of course, do you believe one vaccine is better than the other? Because of course, Johnson & Johnson is one mm-hmm. Vaccination, but it's only what 70% or 68% effective versus Pfizer Moderna, where you get two and like 98%. And of course, as time go on with new strains that is developing, and I think we're probably gonna have another one before this year is out, which one within your personal research and data do you feel is one more effective than the other, or do you feel that it's all just borderline?
Right. And so that's a great question. And that's certainly a question weighing on a lot of people's minds. Pfizer in the US, and you actually found out you have to like look at what country you're talking about, because there's actually different efficacy rates depending on what country you're talking about because of the different variants that exist across the globe. So I'll just talk about within the US. So Pfizer, I think you noted that it's at like 95%, Moderna's at like 94%, and then Johnson & Johnson in the US is actually at 72% efficacy. Now, what that means is that the way that number comes out, they're talking about the way you get, how many symptoms, you know, if you get symptoms or not, and what percentage of people may show symptoms even after having gotten the vaccination. But the important point, and this, I can't stress this enough, each of these, no matter which one you pick, has prevented death and has prevented severe illness. In fact, no one who has taken any of these three has died after getting COVID. So in other words, they got the vaccination, they encounter COVID somehow, nobody dies. That's key, because obviously people without this are dying. And so even if you choose to the 72% Johnson & Johnson, at least you know you most likely you're not going to die, because nobody has yet from after having that vaccination. So, and a lot, the biggest benefit to Johnson & Johnson is the fact that because it's the adenovirus and it has the way that it's transported and then injected, it does not have to be in sub-zero temperatures, which means that it's easier to transport around the U.S. wherever it needs to go, to rural areas included, because some of those, you know, if you have to have a deep freezer refrigerator truck, that's a lot more expensive than just a regular truck. Also, where you're keeping it, smaller medical facilities don't have the deep freeze capacity of some of these like industrial size hospitals of the larger urban centers. So J&J is actually, I think, tailor-made for rural areas and impoverished areas where the medical facilities are not as they're not as big and as enterprise level kind of quality. So, and also because it's the more traditional type, I think it's, if you're worried about a vaccine, go with Johnson & Johnson, because that's the more tried and true, method of creating vaccines. Yeah. So, if you're worried and, you know, because they rushed like the Moderna or the Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson was done the old school way. And it's only one shot. So some people can make it like a trek to somewhere far away to get one shot. They wouldn't be able to do it for two shots, but they could do it for one. And so again, Johnson & Johnson, and another benefit to Johnson & Johnson is that its trials happened later, after Moderna and Pfizer ones. So it actually caught some of the variants within its trials. So we know it works against some of those variants, whereas we, you know, it's a question mark with Pfizer and Moderna. Because I think even Moderna at one point, they were saying they might need a booster at some point to handle like the South African variant. But Johnson & Johnson was in the test, was in the trials while that variant was prevalent. So they were able to catch that. And so to me, I think anybody who's like on the fence, you want to go Johnson & Johnson, old school. It's going to be more readily available. It's one shot. Like it just the convenience, the coverage, even though that number. And this is the other part. I think Fauci said like you only need between 60 and 70% efficacy anyway. So when we heard 95 and 94, we got all excited, right. But it was way more than we needed. So now when we hear one that's actually right there at 72, we're like, let me get that. Where's my 90? Right. But you really, in terms of the effectiveness and what we need, any of them are good. Get the first one that's available. But I think for those who are like a little iffy, go with that Johnson & Johnson.
It's a name we trust anyway, right?
That's the other part. Like, it's like, to me, like the more and more I read about it, I was like, dang, that's kind of sneaking up on us. You know,
aren't they suing Johnson & Johnson for baby powder? I'm just
they have an ongoing. But I want to say this. So what are your thoughts on some people's, I guess, dilemma or being with the first shot? Based off of what I heard, the first shot, typically people only experience soreness in their arm. That's the only thing that I've heard. With the second shot, the side effects are a little more severe with some people and may take 1 to 2 days for recovery, or they feel down having flu-like symptoms, as opposed to the Johnson & Johnson with one shot. You know, do you think that's going to be a one shot, one kill kind of thing? Not literally, but do you think people will experience more side effects with it since it is one shot, as opposed to the two that you're kind of building your immunity up to it with that first one? And my thought process was people that had taken the shot, the first one, and they didn't have many side effects, I felt like they had already been exposed to it anyway. And maybe that's why they didn't have the side effects that were expected, like you do with the flu. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So actually what I have read is that surprisingly, Johnson & Johnson, the people who've gotten that, that vaccination, have experienced less side effects than either the first dose or second dose of Moderna. And I think it may be due in part because of because of the nature of the adenovirus is how it's delivered. And again, that's the more traditional one that we've been, you know, that's how the flu shot is done, for example. It's actually reported so far, people are having less side effects with the Johnson & Johnson. Outside of it being an adenovirus, I don't know an explanation for why, but I can say that is what the research has shown so far, that it's had less side effects than either the first or second dose of the Moderna or Pfizer. So
it's definitely good to know. I mean, Since everybody's not going to have an opportunity to receive the Johnson & Johnson, it's everybody. I mean, that's just the facts, right?
And yeah.
Wanting to get vaccinated so fast, a lot of people did go with the Moderna and Pfizer.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but you know, in fact, to that point about who's getting them, I did want to say something about, I know that there's a lot of, as we say, a lot of African Americans who are concerned, and Latinos too, who are concerned about getting any of these vaccinations. What's interesting though, then on the flip side, you have what you have called vaccine chasers or vaccine hunters. And these are people who sign up on social media and like get into a group and try to identify where there are vaccines that there's an opportunity where they might go bad. And then they're going to be in line for like, they're going to be the people like, oh, okay, well don't, if you're just going to throw them away, you know, we'll take them kind of thing. And so there are people who are out there who are actually signed up to do this. And they're like, okay, we're going to meet at 3 PM, head out to, Pomona. And I know that there's, you know, they're probably going to have like a dozen extra shots. So who's with me? You know, so it's interesting to me that there's people who, like you said, are kind of in a rush to get them. And then other people who are like, I ain't getting them. You know, there's that whole range. And in order to reach herd immunity, we need at least 60 to the number they said is about 60 to 65% of the population to get it. And of course, herd immunity is a state where enough people have immunity to the or have been vaccinated or have had it so that it's harder for the virus to spread to anybody because it's only hitting people who've already had it and it can't go anywhere. It can't get to the people that, you know, so, and, you know, with all the questions out there about who's going to get it and when, it's hard to say when we might reach that. You got Biden saying now, he thought it was July, but it's going to actually be in May where we have enough vaccines for everybody by the end of May. But again, let's make sure we remember the distinction between vaccines and vaccinations. All the vaccines might be here in the U.S., but not everybody in the U.S. might be, you know, may not be taking them. So, but according to the latest, we'll have them all here by the end of May. So we'll see. Hopefully people will, you know, do the right thing and we can get out of this mess, you know.
I don't think the Black community is anywhere near 60 to 65%. My research, I think the Caucasian community is, but we're nowhere near that. Yeah. So we have a long way to go. Yes. So continue to speak out and encourage.
Cool.
Your community to get that vaccine.
Yeah. Oh, one thing I was going to say is that it looks like frontline and 65 plus, of course, they're allowed to get it or able to get it right now. It won't be until March 15th in LA anyway. I can't speak to Indiana, but in Los Angeles, it won't be until March 15th, but they'll start to begin to open it up to others with exceptions. And I actually tried to do this right before this call. I tried to sign up and get my spot to see what, you know, just to see what the website would tell me. And it simply told me you're not eligible. Wow. So I'm gonna check again on March 15th to see if that message comes back any differently. You know, we're still in the thick of it. Hopefully people get more comfortable with it. It's really through this. I'm really glad you guys invited me because it actually pushed me to do even further research. And I think, as I stated, I think Johnson & Johnson has kind of crept up. It was the last in the pack and now it's kind of leading the pack as far as a favorite, just because, again, one shot. The side effects, at least up to this point, were reported as less. And it's just as effective doing what we needed to do. So,
well, I have a question for you, Emmanuel. Of course, with you doing miles and miles and knowing data and research, I just saw, I want to say, maybe it was NBC Nightly News, where Texas is going to start lifting restrictions. Do you feel within this time where there are a lot of people are getting, you know, vaccinated, but do you think this is a time that Texas is going to see a very severe setback versus, you know, what's going on now? Because Biden just stated, wear your mask. He was actually just on Instagram. It was like basically telling people, do not. So do you think they're at a point now where they can relax to that point without setting themselves back 50 feet?
Short answer is no. I think Texas does everything big. And I think they're making a big mistake right here. You know, it's one thing to say, let's open it up. I understand that. Trust me. I understand it. Mimi and I work for a live events company. It's been hit harder than most industries. So we know what that means to people's and people's pocketbooks and their livelihood. That's one thing. But why are you getting rid of masks? It's like, in fact, masks would help you do your 100% open business even better or more, or at least more safely. I'm surprised, along with a lot of other people, why you would at this time where. And by the way, even though the numbers have dropped from what we saw in December and January during the holiday months where we'd expect them to be higher, they've come down, but they've only come down to, you guys remember back in June and July of last summer? We were alarmed at the number of deaths and hospitalizations. And guess what? We've dropped to that level, not under that. So we've just adjusted our expectation because it was so high during the holidays. It's only come down to June and July of last summer. So I'm shocked at what, at that choice the Texas governor made. I think Mississippi, they did the same thing. It's hard to talk about why you make that choice when you got all these variants running around. We are close. Like, you know, we didn't have these vaccines at our disposal last year when it was, you know, when we were being hit that hard, but we still are not out of it. And if we don't make the right moves, before the variants catch us, then that's that potential of the fourth surge that's been talked about. One upside, though, which I think was a question up until about late February, and that's that there's finding out now. Before, they thought if you got the vaccine at the that it would protect you from hospitalization and severe illness. Now they're actually saying that it will also prevent you from spreading it. That was always the hope, but now they have some test results, because Israel went, you know, they've been doing the best in terms of they have 9 million people. So they have that going for them, but they've done a lot with Pfizer. And so they're saying it actually does help reduce transmission as well as symptoms and severity. So that's actually great news, because the more people that do that, the less it'll spread. So, yeah.
More people that, you know, really pay attention to their own health and keep their mask on,
right,
and not necessarily listen to what they're being guided to do, they'll be safer. You know, you have to use your personal judgment in a time like this. You can't go and take your mask off and party it up and live your best life like you did 3 years ago. It's just not the same. So we have to take a personal responsibility to do what we have to do to maintain a safe and healthy life as much as we can.
Keep
your mask on. I am.
Me too. I actually had made the personal decision that I was probably going to wear the mask for the rest of this year, to be honest. One thing about COVID, and I'm pretty sure you all can agree, is that this particular, whatever you want to call it, illness, disease, variant, you know, some names that people shouldn't say, I guess, it made you just realize this is not just about your personal health. So many people, family members have been affected to where now you don't even know if you have it. And that still is correct. I mean, there are people still walking around, you don't know you had it. So one thing I realized is that if you're not just doing this for you, you're doing this for family, friends, people that you don't know. And I was just in the store last weekend here in North Carolina, I walked past several people that did not have a mask on. It wasn't like in a major retail store, because now we are seeing those signs, you know, some say you can't enter without a mask. But I was still just so shocked to where I'm like, okay, if you don't care about yourself, what about the next person or the next person, you know? And of course, here in North Carolina, they are easing restrictions where bars are now open a couple hours later. Capacity within bars and restaurants, as well as sporting events, I think we were at 25% capacity. Now they're raising up to 50%. So it's almost like we are jumping the gun. And I do feel that, even though I know they say big brothers watch you, I want to do what I want to do, it's almost like we all need to come together as unified in order to try to, I wouldn't say defeat this or control it, because COVID is now it's going to be a part of everyday life. I don't think it's ever going away, and it's just going to keep mutating and mutating and mutating until, you know, it is what it is. And, you know, I think at this time, I am someone that may not be the first in line to get a shot, or probably not even eligible to get a shot. But, you know, I do trust your personal research, as well as I know you are a subject matter expert within, you know, reading data, I should say. So, you know, I do think, you know, after speaking, the Johnson & Johnson probably will be a way for my family and I. And one thing I want to say is, of course, we're all interested. This has been part of our everyday lives now for over a year. What was it that really made you like really want to do a research? Like, have you had someone, if you want to answer this personally, affected? Like, I've had some family members, you know, that have had this, that made me look into some things even more. But is it because that's just like, you know, your passion within research and data, you know, analysis? Or, you know, have you had people close to you affected by this virus?
Sure. Yeah, I have no problem talking about that. My sister got a mild case. She's a teacher in Minnesota. In St. Paul. And, she got a mild case of COVID, back in May of last year. And you know, it was a mild case, but, she has told me, I've checked in with her a couple of times, you know, even this year about it. She lost her sense of taste and smell. Smell never came back. So she can only smell things if she has it like right under her nose. So out of all the, you know, she didn't get hospitalized, you know, she's still alive. That's obviously what's most important. But I've had friends. I have a friend who used to, you know, she runs half marathons. After she had it, she actually had a rougher time with it, was down for about a week, and then thought she was better, and then was down for another couple of days. And now she can't run as far without being a lot more exhausted than she was. She worked at a shelter, so she got it from the shelter. So all these people who are doing good, teachers and people working in shelters, right, they're the ones who get it, right? Frontline workers. But for me, it's actually kind of more comical of what sometimes pushes me into this. I have a group, a social group of people that I've been talking to since the pandemic. And there's just people on there that just go, that spout off, you know what I'm saying? They just be pulling information from every which part of their bodies that where information shouldn't come from. I get as a person who's, I'm a stickler, you know, like I'm that person. Sometimes people are like, don't buy the email. He'll like be trying to get too specific, right? But I'm that dude. So, and So I had too many conversations with these guys, right? So then I became, within our like 7-person group, I became the person who was like, you know, okay, for the official word, let's go to him, you know, because we know that he's going to do the diligence and like, and cross check and recheck, because this information has evolved, you know, like, yeah. Obviously we know that there was definitely questions about like, should we wear masks or not wear masks at first? You know, I think, you know, everybody, I think kind of the point where you said Fauci kind of messed up on that. He should have said, wear whatever you can, while you can, but we wanted to keep materials available for the people who needed it the most. I get it. But, you know, that was a mixed message out at the outset. That's been cleared up. Definitely need to be wearing those now. But yeah, so that's what kind of pushed me, you know, my personality and that situation kind of pushed me to get that definitive information. And I just found it really fascinating because of the fact that it was a different process by which they decided to create these. Not just that we sped it up, but that we're trying a whole new way. This mRNA business, it's a whole new way of immunizing. We just hadn't tried before. And so I found that very, very interesting. And then as the vaccines came out, and we're talking about the numbers, but data is my world. So that just kind of followed. It just kind of fell right into it. So,
well, yeah, I would definitely read your blog. I read the news article because, you know, I do trust you. You know, I give out. Like, hey, we have someone.
Yeah. I don't have anything for outside of California, but there are a couple websites. There's one called myturn.ca.gov, which is where people can go in order to get themselves scheduled for a vaccination. And if you want information, you can go to Vaccinate All 58, because we have 58 counties in California. So it's called VaccinateAll58.com. But those are places where I've gone for information. I always like to share information and then talk about where I get it. So people, yeah. You know, just as a bibliography kind of credibility piece. But yeah, that's why I got into it. And that's what I do.
I love it.
Don't forget about the people who don't have internet access. A lot of those sites require, a lot of the locations, the sites where they're doing it require you have internet access. And
you raise a great point.
Communities don't have it.
So you're absolutely right. And that's actually, one of the reasons why, they're going to, like, you know, the Walgreens of certain small towns, mm-hmm. And making it available, or whatever particular, pharmacy outlet that they have in those places where, like you mentioned, they don't, internet access is not widely available. And we can only hope that people, that somebody's, you know, within somebody's family or within somebody's social circle, mm-hmm. they connect with those folks that can tell them, hey, by the way, I know that they're going to be, you know, or even just, I guess, old school, right? Like we operated before the internet in this planet, right? Before cell phones even. So, they're going to have to go with old school methods of informing people when and where to get these vaccines. And
it's funny you mentioned that, because, a lot of people also transportation to get there, even though it's located in your area. So I think I read and saw also on, NBC Nightly News where Lyft and Uber, are offering free rides for senior citizens, as well as other individuals, I guess, to just take you, pick you up from your home, take you to Walgreens, CVS, or a location, wait on you. And then also, I forgot, what is the time frame between the vaccines? And then they're actually going to come back around that same time, pick you up again and take you back. So,
right. Yeah. So Pfizer is a 21 days, between doses. And Moderna is 4 weeks or 28 days between doses. Mm. And of course, as we mentioned before, Johnson & Johnson's the one shot. I didn't realize like how much that would make a difference. Cause like you mentioned, if transportation is difficult, it's definitely, if it's difficult one time, it's twice as difficult two times. Right. Mm-hmm. And so when you can find an option that works for just that one time, that it opens up the possibility. Like there's certain people who probably said, I'm not going to get it, cause I can't afford to take two trips that far from where I live. But one trip, you might be able to work that out. And so, it is definitely a challenge. I know that, Biden and Kamala, they have some plans to try to address that specifically. I heard that 40% of the Johnson & Johnson are going to be provided, strictly to Black and Brown communities because of that's what's so crazy, right? We get the double whammy. Like one, we're worse hit by it. Like when the Black and Brown people get it, it tends to be more severe. Two, we have apprehension because the medical, community in these United States have not treated as well. over the long haul. And so we have apprehension. And then you have the people who have, access to it. So like there's so many hurdles, to hit. And yet we're the people who probably need the vaccinations, the most. So.
Right. And we are, because as you know, and this is going back years and years, grandma, big mama watching all the children while mama, daddy at work. Mm-hmm. Or we also are the ones that are the frontline workers, the bus drivers, the yep. people that are in the grocery store, the people that are afraid to take off. So we are hit the hardest. And in addition to that, the Hispanic community as well is hit the hardest because you're constantly out there. And so I think that's another thing that put us on the forefront. And as well as I know a lot of friends and, you know, family members that have got it that way. Hey, I'm catching a ride, you know, with a coworker home from mm-hmm. work, or I'm doing this, or I'm doing, or you have the people that just don't believe.
Yep.
Traditionally, both of the nationalities you just mentioned are family oriented. So, mm-hmm. you know, when you're around people in your community, it's definitely, and that's where that herd immunity comes into play.
Mm-hmm.
Get it? I understand it, but you still have people that are going to have trust issues, which we understand that. It's very valid, but I think at the end of the day, people just have to do what's best for them. Look at your personal health situation and either way, it's a risk, in my opinion, whether you take the vaccination or not, because mm-hmm. the vaccination is not going to prevent you from contracting COVID-19, right? Yeah. So you don't know how somebody is going to react to it. We just don't know. So you have to use your personal judgment with that and do what you feel is best for you and your health.
Okay. Exactly, exactly. And I know this subject can go on, and I can't wait for us to meet up a few months from now to see the new data that you have, or maybe even be a new vaccine out. And, you know, before wrapping up, I don't know if Mimi J, if you want to elaborate or give any final thoughts as well.
Yeah, I do actually, because coming into this conversation, I'm very adamant about, no, I don't want to take the vaccine because I'm very skeptical, like my trust issues, a lot of the things that we have discussed, I fall into that category. But, you know, I will say having this conversation kind of opened up my mind a little bit because of the fact that you're right, Emmanuel, that this is not something that is directly affected by the African-American community, it is affecting by all of us. So we do kind of have to come together to get this thing under control. So I'm glad we had this conversation. It definitely has opened up my mind in certain aspects. I can't say I'm 100% on board, but just the fact of opening your perspective is wonderful. And that's why we have these conversations.
Cool. That's good to hear. I did want to pose a surprise question to all y'all real quick.
We don't like
She's like, don't do that. who here has gotten a cold or gotten a flu or been sick since March of last year?
I haven't.
Now, ain't that something? Like most people usually get at least one or two colds in a year's time. But they said that because of all this social distancing and masks and everything else, the protocols we've been employing, that even regular sickness is down.
Yes.
And I was like,
allergies, but that's about it.
Okay. Yeah. Somebody pointed out to me last week and I was like, yeah, you're right. I should have had a cold by now. You know, I usually get one or two a year, you know, and I haven't had any. And
wow.
So that right there shows at least there's some credibility in terms of, you know, what masking can do.
I like that question. You really, you know, with everything going on, I didn't think about the common cold.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. My problem is going to be is we are going to open up. The world is going to go back to
running.
That's my fear because, you know, if something's been caged up for so long, people are going to be on a whole nother level. Like, I'm not a clubber anymore, a partier like that, but you know, it's just I'm actually afraid for that point, to be honest. Cause like you stated, my kids are virtual learning. So they're not in school bringing home germs.
Mm.
My husband, he's always worked from home. I'm working from home and going to office maybe 4 times a month, if that, with less than half the capacity is there with 2 masks on. That's something else. Remember, you wear 1 mask, 2 masks, or 3 masks now. But you know, you're right. I'm really afraid of what's going to happen, you know, once all of this go open again.
You're right.
Hopefully the vaccine really works, you know.
But I mean, to your point though, I mean, you know, that video run for a minute, girls gone wild. This is gonna be the world gone wild. You know what I mean? Like people gonna come out like pent up, like, I mean, people been ready for it. Like I can only imagine what it's gonna look like. But like, you know, the hope is that, you know, we have enough in place in terms of immunity that it's not doesn't cause another pandemic, like, you know, in November or whatever. So because we've definitely had enough of this.
We have. Well, it's been an honor and a pleasure having you on Coffee Chronicles. And, you know, one question I would love for our Coffee Chronicles family to chime in on Instagram and our Facebook page. When is the last time you had the common cold? Have you even thought about that? And what are your feelings on when this world does open up again? Are you still going to take your cautious steps and stay 6 feet or still wear a mask or just really lay low on dining out or large gatherings. So you really educated us. I definitely feel all the ladies probably feel that way. And, you know, within your personal research as well as your professional experience within analyzing data, I really do appreciate you sharing your thoughts, your research, as well as your personal opinion with us today on Coffee Chronicles. So thank you so much.
Thanks so much for having me. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank
Don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe.
Yes, like, watch and like. Yes. Thank you, everyone. Coffee Chronicles family, stay safe. Wear your mask, not just for yourself, but for your family, your friends, and for the people you do not know. So you guys have a great, great week and stay safe.